which I do it.
As a resource manager, I think we don't have information about the resource what we have. So the best way to manage resources is to apply precautionary principle. That means you take little as possible and save as much as possible. With the recharge, the coffee, pump as little as possible, you recharge as much as possible. So you know what I mean, recharge movement. But I do have some concerns that in the design of this recharge structure, especially the large one, some of the basic hydrology and hydrological aspects are misunderstood, overlooked. And that we saw in some of the slides, Sundar Bhatt showed. So that's what I was talking about. So you know, what we are trying to do with very technical recharge is that we are minimizing the runoff process. That's what we are doing. There is runoff, we are trying to minimize it. And then you increase soil, both as you go through into soil process, you need to give more time to infiltration. So that means you have to increase the infiltration time. So when you hold the boat in a check dam or a well or whatever, what you're doing is you're not forcing anything, just give it more time. So that slowly it gets into the hydrogen. And it's widely adapted. Some of the structures, many structures that I have seen, and I have seen some satellite images that have used a national, I can't find them in there, boat is just standing. Right? So these are empty. So what I would like to answer is, for your information, why I think they are empty. Right. So that's the idea of this paper. The first thing is that remember wherever we try to do manage and recharge, these are semi-arid regions. That means the rainfall is low. We don't have rainfall. We are trying to recharge, say, water in places where the rainfall is low. Right. So that is the starting point. Now in India, this is the probability curve of annual rainfall. So now what this says is that almost every year you can get up to, you can be guaranteed of getting up to 200 millimeters of water. Every year you will get it. Right? But the Punjab evapotranspiration is close to 1000 meters. So 200 is nothing. Right? Now, average 50% of the time, you can get up to 450 millimeters of rain. That is every other year, you can count on getting 450 millimeters of rain. Even that is compared to 1800, it's nothing. In a very rare situation, this is a 120-year data set. I have used here a 120-year data set. There is one event which had 1000 millimeters. Even that is less than the 1800 millimeter record, the evaporation record. Punjab, as you know, goes rise in water, rise in peak. So the evaporation requirement of rise in peak is at least 1000 millimeters. So we are dealing, trying to do manage aquifer recharge in areas where the water is short. We have land use practices which are not compatible with the water that is available. Now Karnal here is slightly better. Now you will see that Karnal has a maximum rainfall, we have noticed it's a 1448 up to 1400 millimeters. So it's not 1400. It's a little more shift there. And then every year you can expect up to 400 millimeters of rainfall. So the chance of success is Karnal is slightly higher than when you compare to Punjab. Now you can dwell around an argument, you have to about the annual rainfall, what about the daily rainfall? Because only one thing you need is one or two big events. So what I am showing you here is 15 years rainfall of data. So about 5,000 days of rainfall data from Sangur, which is a district within Punjab. Right? And here we are taking the probability of that x-axis here, and also I am putting it in a log scale, not the linear scale. So what that means is that 1 in 10 days, I will get a rainfall of about 2-3 millimeters. 1 in 10 days. 1 in 100 days, I will get a rainfall of about 45 millimeters. 1 in 1000 days, I will get something to the level of 120, and maybe 1 in 10,000 days, I will get a rainfall where you can get substantial flooding and water that is in excess. So our argument for the farmer's interest is 3 months. Remember, he needs a crop in 3 months. And if I talk to you about 100 days, that itself is already long. Right? It's a long. And then 100 days, I'm going to get more than 45, 50 million. So we need to understand this one, especially if you're working with the government, giving money, doing large research action, just do an analysis, the property analysis to figure out, is it worth doing? And then, of course, there's a point scale issue, then the catchment, which yields the water, and so on. So that's the first point. Now, this Sargur, I told you, it has about 950 mm rainfall, is the requirement for rice and wheat. Rainfall is only 4 and 14. This is effective rainfall. There is a lot of kind of activity.
general brings a motor about 400 millimeter, and a ground motor is giving 125 on the average. So with the reach high, whatever happened, the ground levels are going down. So this is equal to about half a meter drop in a year. So that is the required ground level drop in Punjab. Many of us first I told you that there is no water. Now I am telling you there is no land. To do manage that for return, you need land. No farm will give you land. No money will give you. In Punjab, in this Sangur district where we are working now, the total area is 2,400. In case there is 8,700, so it is almost 200% walking intensity. Only a small part there are villages and urban district and there is some land. And then of course this land can have a higher runoff, so you have a roof, you have a road, whatever runoff, and that runoff can be directed into some ponds. And the ponds are collecting sewage. So you really don't want to use it to recharge your aquifer, because you will immediately transfer. So not only what is the constraint in sewage treatment, in the intervention plant, land is also the constraint. Now, just now netting, now they have allowed the water to go inside the soil. Infiltration is finished, right? So now from the soil surface, the water has to move all the way down to the groundwater. In between, you have a soil, large soil column. Now, in case you have a semi-loam soil column, which is usually the agricultural type of soil, this has the property to hold the water to move. The retention is more. So, at a small suction, I will not go into detail, a meter profile, 1 meter profile, and hold up 500 millimeters of water. Just when you don't have any soil to recharge only 50 millimeters, 100 millimeters, but the soil column itself can hold a lot of water. Right? But in case it is a sandy soil or a fractured aquifer like in Saurashtra, then every water that gets under the soil surface will overtake 400 millimeters. It will not hold any water. So that is one of the reasons why Tamil Nadu you don't see much of it. You have a substantial soil column before you hit the hard rock aquifer. Right? So this water is in there. So the soil is the next part of it. Then you can go into a situation in semi-arid regions where there is no space in the aquifer. Then you might tell me or not, why do you want to reach her? But then I will give you an answer for that also. This is in Western Goa, this is in Pakistan. So this particular area is 2.4 million hectares. So this is very large area. This is one of the most prolific aquifers in the world. Right? This has a very intensive network of canal network. The rainfall is only 400 to 500 millimeters, like how Punjab is on the side of the world. What you see here is 1980, the depth to voltage is only 100 centimeters, 1 to 3 meters, very shallow. And then it dropped in 1990, it came back in 2000. Right? So what is happening? These are the areas where the groundwater pumping is also very high. Right? Because the kind of the enhancements so forth to complement, sometimes we use ground surface water, groundwater activity is also very high. But here again, we are constrained by the aquifer capacity itself. Now in Bihar, of course, you don't do a lot of groundwater recharge in Bihar, at least in the northern side of the river. Bihar, what happens is that during the floods, the groundwater gets some water, then it continuously releases the water back into the river. So even if you store it for a short period of time, it gets back to the river and gets out. So aquifer capacity is available. Now, this is again back to Punjab, this Pakistan to Punjab, you see that the groundwater levels, despite all the pumping, all the things, actually rising. Right? Because whatever happens, and you know, going very deep, the bottom line is, where you need water, you have other problems also. Okay, that's it. Now, this is a data from Tushar Shah, he shared it with me. This is the change in groundwater levels in Saurashtra. Now, what you see here, of course, there is significant rising water, what you might have already talked about before. Not because that you have a lot of water, you just didn't have enough capacity to do it. Your aquifer had very limited porosity, very limited intake activity. Just imagine if you have a fine pore, if my fine pore and this fine pore are connected through this, my water can go there. But the interconnectivity is also not there. So water goes, builds up, comes out. Right? So there is very limited capacity and what you see here. And interestingly, this is Shreem's data. In the last 10 years, in Saurashtra, the rainfall is increasing. I don't know, it is anything climate change we have been reading about. Everyone says in the western side of India, the rainfall is going down. If you look at in 1990, the rainfall was about 600 millimeters, it's gradually going up. This is a trend line. So we are talking about rainfall going from 400 millimeters to 800 millimeters. So the prosperity that you see in Saurashtra, of course the downward movement has helped collect the water, but the rainfall also has gone up. So that is something you want to keep it in mind. Yeah? So that's all I have to say. Thank you very much.